Crown the Clown. Written by Elias Witherow. Performed by Kailaan Scott Carter. I was always a spoiled kid. My parents were wealthy and decided to spend their money smothering their only son with an incredible childhood. I had it all. My playroom was insane. A huge TV, pinball machines, and every toy you could imagine. It was awesome. Despite having so much, I wasn't a brat about it. I can say that now, having thoroughly examined my childhood. I loved to share my immense stash of stuff with my friends. I gave toys away, invited them over for pizza and movies, and was all around pretty generous. On paper, I should have been a spoiled snob. But for whatever reason, I wasn't. Good genes, I guess. On my 9th birthday, I had a bunch of my friends over. My dad rented a huge moon bounce for us and decorated our backyard with superhero apparel. I was going through a major phase. Tables were set up with punch and snacks, little finger foods to keep us from complaining until dinner. Balloons and banners were tied to every surface, my parents' way of establishing how loved I was. Music played from giant speakers my dad had set up on the back patio. My friends and I ran around and jammed out while waiting our turn in the moon bounce. My grandparents arrived a couple hours into the party, bringing with them a party gift. My grandmother informed me she had purchased it at a yard sale the weekend prior. It was a giant hollow plastic clown head. It looked like one of those weird cheap toys from the 90s. Something that was popular for a week before getting all of its units shelved. Its face was white with red circles lining the painted eyes. A smile was smeared to its lips. Big goofy grin that was also painted red. The nose was a bulbous orb of plastic that sat oddly on its face like a giant gumball. As I turned over this strange gift in my hands, my grandfather handed me a plastic gold crown. He said it was part of the game. Seeing my confusion, my grandmother laughed and explained what it was. She said I was supposed to wear the clown head while my friends attempted to sneak up and crown me. I flipped the head over and saw serrated notches lining the bald dome where the crown went. I thought it was pretty lame, but didn't want to be rude. I dutifully slid the plastic clown head over my own, the interior hard against my temples. As it settled over me, I realized I couldn't see anything. Red light filtered through the plastic, but there was a concerning lack of eye holes. My grandfather chuckled as he watched me stumble around, hands outstretched so I wouldn't bump into anything. I asked why there were no eye holes, and he told me it'd be too easy for me to win the game. I had to rely on my ears to keep my friends at bay. He said the game was called Crown the Clown. I was beginning to understand the rules. It was like some weird version of Pin the Tail on the Donkey, but with a clown and a crown instead. My friends had gathered around to watch me, and soon they were laughing and calling out for me. My grandmother tossed one of them the crown and the game began. It was surprising fun. The plastic mask got hot, but I didn't mind. I was too caught up in keeping my friends away from me and the crown off my head. After 20 minutes passed and still no one had managed to get me, I was laughing and stumbling around, doing my best not to bump into anything. My friend John was calling out to me, and I didn't know if he had the crown or if he was trying to distract me. Turns out, he was trying to distract me. I suddenly felt something click over my head, followed by a great cheer from my friends. I had finally been crowned. Smiling despite my defeat, I went to take the big plastic head off me, but found that I couldn't. The neck hole was suddenly smaller, curling tight under my chin and biting into my skin. I tugged harder, trying not to panic. The air inside the head had already grown thick. I wrapped my fingers around the base of the head, pulling up as hard as I could. I felt rough edges cut into me, and I immediately stopped. I could hear my friends laughing at me. I'm sure I looked ridiculous, but at that time, I didn't find any humor in the situation. Sweat dripped into my eyes, and I blinked against the burning sensation. My breath blew back at me from the tight walls of the head, the red light filtering through the eye paint, making me dizzy and disoriented. I was suddenly very aware of how claustrophobic the clown head was. I called out for someone to help me, doing my best to keep panic from my voice. Still laughing, one of my friends came to my aid. I felt his hands around my ears, and suddenly I screamed as he jerked upward. Pain exploded around my face, and I shoved him away from me, panting. Why couldn't I get this thing off me? It had been so easy to put on, sliding comfortable over my head with a little room to spare. But now everything was squishing in on me, the opening flush against my throat. I suddenly realized my nose was bent against the plastic, bent painfully to the right. I then understood what was happening. The clown head was shrinking. I screamed for someone to get my dad, sweat pouring from my face. The head stunk, and the combination of unfiltered breath and sweat made me lightheaded. My throat was parched, but my lips were lined with perspiration. I felt the burning fingers of claustrophobia wrap around my mind. The head squeezed a little tighter. I screamed again for my dad, my vision obscured by the head. I suddenly heard him in the front of me and felt his hands trace the outer surface of my prison. His voice changed from amusement to worry in a matter of seconds, and that scared me even more. I tried tugging at the head again, yelling into the plastic dome, explaining that it was getting tighter and tighter. My dad heard the panic in my voice, and I felt him uselessly struggle to remove my source of agony. His fingers traced the now compressed opening at the bottom. He tried to slide his fingers between the lip of the base and my skin, but just ended up choking and gagging me as his knuckles burrowed into my throat. The clown head's grip on my head tightened further. I wheezed and sunk to my knees, the heat and lack of oxygen causing my head to swim. My dad was yelling at my friends, instructing them to go retrieve something from the woodshed. I didn't hear much, instead concentrating on my breathing. My head throbbed as the hard plastic compressed my skull like a grape waiting to pop. I heard my mom's concerned voice, a shrill inquiry that my dad ignored. I felt his fingers try to pry the head off my throat again. He could tell I was fading. Panic cracked his voice as he yelled at my friends to hurry. His fingers were back at my throat, digging desperately, trying to give me some kind of relief. I knelt before him, swaying slightly and sucking in hot, stinking air. Suddenly, my father tried to jam his hand further in, and I felt my gag reflex engage and my stomach rolled as I dry retched into the hot plastic. My body hitched, and I felt another wave coming. I tried to fight it, but it was like trying to stop a train. I vomited into the mask, regurgitated soda and pretzels gushing into the tight space. I gasped, and the smell alone brought another gout rocketing from my lips. It sloshed around my face, filled my ears, the hot bile splashing against my skin with nowhere to go. It was trapped inside the head along with me, and I was drowning in it. It came to just above my nostrils, a slimy yellow line below my eyes. My father heard me gurgling inside the head and quickly laid me on my back, the vomit pouring around my ears and giving me a pocket to breathe. I gasped in the putrid air and felt the plastic tighten again, a wet, hard compress that began to fill my vision with darkness. I felt my strength begin to leave my body. My head was wrapped with an iron grip, and I didn't know how much longer I'd last in its clutches. Suddenly, my friend returned with the item my father had asked for. I heard him instructing me, his voice drowned out by the puke in my ears. He slowly turned me on my side, and I coughed and gagged against the slurping vomit. My nose felt like it was breaking against the walls of my prison. My ears burned and sweat coated my skin. I felt my father slide something cold and hard along the side of my neck, just under the lip of the head. I immediately knew what it was, a crowbar. I grit my teeth, tears pouring from my eyes as my dad apologized, his voice cracking with desperation. I howled as he applied pressure, the crowbar burrowing into my neck muscles. To my relief, I felt the mask give a little, just a slight lift that allowed some of the vomit to trickle out. Suddenly, the clown head tightened again, squeezing my skull harder than I could bear. I thrashed on the ground, screaming in agony, clawing at my head. I felt like my skull would explode from the pressure, and the darkness swam closer. I heard my father instruct my friends to hold me still as he readjusted the crowbar. Sweaty hands pinned me to the earth as my head was pushed sideways. I felt my father hovering over me, the cold tongue of the crowbar licking the side of my neck. My father was apologizing over and over. I knew something bad was about to happen. My muscles bulged in revolt as my dad jammed the crowbar under the lip, digging into my skin and drawing blood. He shoved it in until I felt its hard surface resting against my cheek. I tensed, warm blood streaming down my neck across my shoulders. I heard my father whisper into my ear to brace myself. Suddenly, overwhelming pressure cut into the side of my face, and I thrashed violently, clutching and tearing out handfuls of grass as pain shot across my cheek and neck like spreading lightning. The edge of the crowbar crunched into my jaw as my father applied pressure, a last-ditch effort to remove the clown head before it killed me. Tears ran down my face, and red darkness shook my world. Puke and sweat coated my face as I tried to escape the pain. My friends held me in place and I heard one of them crying. My teeth cracked against each other as my father continued to pull upward. With a sickening popping sound, I heard my jaw break, and suddenly I was taken to a level of splintering agony I didn't know existed. My tongue waggled and went numb in my mouth. I felt a molar tear free from my gums. It tumbled across my tongue like bloody candy. I felt howling darkness rush me as it swallowed me. I felt the sudden surge of cool air as the clown head cracked and finally shattered. As I blacked out, I felt my father shaking me, clutching me in his arms. His voice faded into the nothing. I awoke in the hospital a few hours later, my face wrapped and contorted around some plastic that kept my jaw in place. I felt woozy and sick, an IV bag by my bed dripping relief into my bloodstream. My mother and father were at my side, eyes bloodshot and filled with concern. My grandparents sat on the other side of the bed, my grandmother crying. As soon as they saw I was awake, they began to apologize all at once. My father for doing what he did and my grandparents for exposing me to such horrors. Their voices all babbled into one, and I let my eyes close once again, the drugs pumping through my body, lulling me into a comfortable sleep. Thinking back on that day, I can still feel that horrible clown head, the way it smelled, the way the light filtered through the plastic. The weight of it resting across my skull. It's like one sick joke now. All these years later, now that I've recovered from the event, I can't help but feel disgusted amusement. Because you see, my jaw has never healed properly, and there's twisted scar tissue lining my cheek where the crowbar cut into me. My jaw is in a constant state of crooked humor, like a painful half-smile. Combined with the scar tissue stretching from my lips, well, some would say I look kind of like a clown.
The Painting of a Hallway, written by William Dalphin, performed by Steve Taylor, featuring Jesse Cornett, Brindolyn McNair, Eden, and Otis Jiry.
Hi, I got a delivery for you. Yeah, need to sign here. Thanks a lot. Have a good day.
I got this package in the mail from my dad. Brown paper wrapping, large but flat, with the word fragile written on it in black ink. When I unwrapped it, it was this big acrylic painting framed in some sort of bronze gilded plaster. The painting was of this long hallway full of doors, kind of like you'd see in a fancy hotel. The walls had edging about halfway up. The upper part was painted in off-white, while the lower half was a crimson red that blended into the carpeting. Between each door was an upturned light. There was also one on the far wall at the end where the corridor seemed to connect to another hallway, running perpendicular to it, disappearing around a corner. It was really amazing detail, though I wouldn't call it lifelike by any means. Just the sheer amount of intricate pieces to each aspect of the scene showed that the artist really paid attention to every little thing, like somewhere in the world was this hallway, and you could stand in it and hold the painting up in front of you, and if it weren't for the border and the clearly stylized art, you wouldn't be able to tell where the canvas ended and the real world began. I called him up and thanked him immediately. When I asked him where he'd found it, all he said was that he got it in an auction. I kind of figured as much. So I hung up the painting in my office, just behind my desk, which I later realized wasn't the best place for it. In order to actually look at it, I had to swivel completely around, but there wasn't anywhere better, really, and once I'd gotten it hung up, I felt less willing to take it back down, so I just left it there. It kind of hung out over my shoulder and watched me work, and every now and then I'd turn around and stare at it and get entranced by it, feeling like I could get up and put my hands in the frame and climb into the painting as if the frame were a window. Of course, I wouldn't be writing this if something weird didn't happen as a result of the painting. We had a couple of friends over named Mark and Sabina. Mark and I went into my office when the women started talking about knitting, my wife's new favorite hobby. I sat down at my laptop to find a video I'd been telling Mark about, and Mark wandered over and started admiring the painting.
Where'd you get that?
My dad bought it at an auction and gave it to me.
It's creepy.
It's not that creepy. It's kind of... I don't know.
Hypnotic?
Yeah. I turned around to look at it with him while the video loaded. He got up close and ran his finger over the canvas, feeling the raised acrylic. And I just let my gaze wander over all the details again. I didn't notice that before.
What?
At the end of the hall, there's some sort of light coming from around the corner, and it's casting a shadow on the floor. I got up and looked closer. I really hadn't spent a lot of time studying the far end of the hallway. There was definitely some yellow and some darker colors making what looked like the shadow of a person coming from around the corner. I even reached out and touched it to make sure it wasn't some trick of the light in the study, just making it look like there was this shadow in the painting. But I felt the acrylic, and sure enough, the shadow was actually there in the painting.
See what I mean? Creepy.
I genuinely felt weirded out about it. It was one of those moments where you start thinking, why didn't I notice this earlier? Was it there to notice? A couple days later, I was working on a project in my study. It was about 9:30 at night, and I just couldn't focus. So I spun around in my chair to take a look at the painting, and I felt this sudden vertigo effect, like the ground wasn't there. And I had to grab my chair to keep from tumbling into emptiness. You wouldn't have noticed it if you hadn't looked at the painting 100 times like I had. The hallway was long, with exactly 6 doors. I remember because I counted them the first day. 3 on the left, 3 on the right, each with a little shiny metal doorknob. Only now, there were 7 doors. 3 on the left, 4 on the right. It didn't make sense. Everything looked proportionally exactly the same, and the far end of the corridor was just as far away. And yet there was a 4th door on the right side of the hallway, with its little metal doorknob. I didn't even know which door was the 4th door. That's how well it blended in. I just knew that there were 4 doors, where once there were 3. What is going on? I turned away in my chair and looked back, checking several times to make sure my eyes weren't playing tricks on me, but the number of doors remained constant. 7. I called my dad again.
Hello? Hey, Dad, it's me. How are you doing?
Oh, can't complain. And to what do I owe the pleasure?
I've got a question.
All right.
Be honest. Is this a trick painting you sent me?
Oh, what do you mean?
I mean, it keeps changing. I can see it changing.
Not as far as I know. It was just one in a bunch I picked up, all at the same auction. Why do you ask? Is something wrong?
Oh, no, just curious. Thanks, Dad.
You're welcome, son. Anytime.
I've got to go. I'll talk to you later, okay? I love you, Dad.
Love you too, son. Have a nice day.
I will. Thanks again, Dad. Bye. After I got off the phone, I took the painting down and checked the back for some sort of mechanical or digital hocus-pocus, but it was all soft canvas. I left it on the floor behind my office chair facing the wall. The mere thought of it was freaking me out. The next day, I pulled my wife Melissa into my office and held the painting up so she could see it. She hadn't had a chance to do so before. How many doors are there?
Seven.
There were six when I first got this. She just looked at me like I was being a goofball.
Okay, so which one wasn't there before?
I have no idea.
Oh, you don't know which door magically appeared?
No, but...
Honey, I'm in the middle of something. Tell you what. Come and find me when you figure it out.
Melissa went back into the other room. It gets worse. The next time I chatted with Mark, I told him about the extra door in the painting.
Are you sure there weren't seven doors to begin with?
I know what you're thinking, Mark, but I would swear I counted six.
Well, if another one shows up, at least Melissa counted seven and can confirm it then. You know what you should do? You should take a photo of the painting so you can prove it if anything else changes.
It was a great idea. I got my phone and took a photo of the painting. 2 days went by, nothing happened. On the third day, I walked into my office, and there was a man staring at me. Well, I mean, it wasn't. I can't say that it was a man or a woman. Honestly, I can't even say that it was human. There was a shape at the end of the hallway in my painting. It oddly lacked the same detail that the rest of the painting had, like someone had hurriedly painted it on. I even ran my hand over it to make sure it wasn't fresh, that someone hadn't actually come in and painted over the original work, just trying to drive me crazy. It was completely dry. The look of it scared me more than anything else, changing painting included. I wish I could do it more justice with words, but the best I can describe it is that it was human-ish, with legs and arms, but squat or hunched and lopsided like somebody had slapped a blurry Quasimodo onto an otherwise beautiful painting. You couldn't see the details of its face, but you could see shading on it, defining warped features. I was almost glad there wasn't more detail to it, except for the fact that it left just enough to the imagination to give one nightmares. But I had proof. Here was proof that the painting was changing. So I brought up the file on my laptop to show my wife for comparison. But when I did, the figure was in the photo I took too. At no point did I start questioning my sanity about all this. Something unnatural and terrifying was going on. So I took the painting out of the house and set it on the curb where we put our trash for pickup. I was so done with that painting. Or so I thought. The next evening when I got home from work, it was gone from the curb. I figured someone had seen it and taken it home, and I waved my hands and thought, good, now it's someone else's problem. I went inside, played with my daughter Gabby, had dinner, put Gabby to bed, and after watching a show with my wife, went into my office to check my email. No, the painting wasn't back on the wall. I made sure of that the moment I walked into the room. But I got a message from Mark asking if the painting had changed again and asking me to call him to talk about it. I got him on the line and I told him about the creepy new addition and how I'd gotten rid of the painting.
Oh man, that sounds cool. I wish I'd gotten a chance to see it.
Well, I can send you the photo I took of it.
Cool.
So I opened the image file. The thing in the painting had raised its arms. Before, you could only barely make out the arms hanging at its sides, but now, both arms were raised up over its head, and its fingers were spread apart like it was waving hello at me. I think it was waving hello at me. I zoomed in as best as I could without pixelating the image, and the shaded contours of the face seemed stretched into a grin. Oh, no, 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 no. I sent Mark the file, but the connection kept dropping, so I put it in a folder on my Dropbox account and gave him access to it.
The file's corrupted.
I tried to open it as well, but Mark was right. Every time I copied the image, it somehow got corrupted.
Ooh, it must be spooky magic.
This isn't funny. I'm freaking out here.
Sorry. Delete the file if it's scaring you so bad.
And that's exactly what I did. I deleted the file. But it gnawed at me, you know?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.